We're all familiar with the account of Ananias and Sapphira in chapter 5 of the book of Acts. There are a number of things about it, the first one being that it's the first sin in the church that the Bible records. But there's a point about it that I want to make that Peter told Ananias that's very important to our lives in becoming Christians and in living the Christian's life. Verse 4, Peter asks, "Whiles it remained, was it not thine own?" And the point I want to emphasize is the next part. "And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power?" And you start thinking about that and realize we're free moral agents. We have the power of choice. And we need to ask ourselves, do I ever really sit down and consider how much God has put in my own power? Because what we do is act too much like most of the world and blame somebody else for what we had power over, what we chose to do. Somebody even said elections have consequences. That's because of the power we have to do what we do. And who gave us that power? Who made us as we are? Well, of course, God did. This means that he has given us responsibility and we must give an account to him for what we have in our own power. So sometimes, we often mention this part of it, count your blessings, name them one by one. Well, stop and count what is under your own power, under your control. God has put into your hands certain things that you will determine how they're used. And I think, first of all, we will notice that he's put what we call our possessions, because that has a direct bearing on what Peter said. Yes, we're stewards. We take care of what God gave us. And he gave us the ability to possess. And we're to possess and use whatever it is. Even our own bodies are living to be presented as living sacrifices, which is our reasonable service. But we're accountable to God for what we do with them. We can end up like the rich man in Luke 12 and verse 16. Or, to the other extreme, we can be like the widow who cast in her last mite, Mark 12 and 41. Notice those extremes. One was totally selfish. If he got more, he'd just build bigger barns or whatever it would take to put what belonged to him. The other one, the widow, had little. Yet what she gave was all she had. And that's the key to the thing. And yet both of them had put into their own power, their control, what they had. And thus they had the power to use it for what they desired to use it for. So the choice is in our own power. Now you can break that down to specifics in your own life. Whatever's involved in a man's life, he marries a husband's wife, as he becomes a father, the father's life. What's put into your power there? And the same with a woman, wife, and mother. What's in our power? Or as a neighbor, as the Bible defines neighbor. Or as a brother and sister in Christ. What's in my power? God has put it there. It fits being a free moral agent. I choose what I do with it. You go back to the beginning, it was in Eve's own power to keep the commandment or not. She had to make the choice. Cain and Abel, it was in Cain's own power to kill Abel or not. He made the choice. But it's so very easy for us to pass the buck. For us to say it's somebody else's business, it's not my responsibility, and so on. Now, of course, we do get ourselves into situations, and when we get in those situations, sometimes it's not in our own powers what happens to us. Even though we made the choice to go there, what's happening when we get there, we may lose control of it. Being the person that's very agile at my stage of life, I found myself the last 2 days, not yesterday, but Thursday and Friday, and we were up here tangling my feet up in the vines and hitting the ground. Well, it was in my power to be out there in the vines trying to cut them down, but I assure you, when my feet got tangled up, I didn't choose that. And when I was falling, all I could think of, well, I've fallen on one of these, as we used to say at home, one of these stobs. Well, there are some things not within our own power. But yet the choice we made to put us there, then what happens to us is not in our own power, but the choice to go there was in our own power. I know for a fact that I'm responsible for what I think about. I'm responsible for how my mind works. And that's why we have, as we studied many weeks ago on Wednesday night, what Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:7, which should characterize every faithful child of God. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. We talk about if you have a good marriage, you have to work at it. That's true. You have to be willing to follow the will of God and make your marriage like God wants it to be, the role of husband and wife and so forth. But it's equally true that if I have a good mind, I got to work at it. I don't fill it with things that work against living the Christian life. I don't make choices that lead me to worse choices. Evil companionship corrupts good morals. Well, I have the choice. It's what kind of companionship I choose, who I spend my time with, what kind of an influence they are for good or for bad. So what we own, our bodies, to be presented to God as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is our reasonable service. That's within my own power as to what I do. What about time? Surely it's in our own power to use it as we ought to use it. Well, our soul certainly then should be considered as being that which is within our own power as to heaven or hell. We have the power, it's in our own power, to accept the grace or the favor of God that no man can merit and no man deserves by belief and obedience to the gospel. The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live righteously and soberly and godly in this present world. Titus 2:11-12. We cannot serve God and mammon, God and material things. You'll love one, hate the other, hate the one, despise the other. You cannot serve both of them. Matthew 6:24. We can act to save our own souls. That's the power I have. Through obedience to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Or I just do nothing, be not interested in anything pertaining to the New Testament or anything pertaining to the Bible, and lose our own souls. I have that within my power. And I think I've mentioned many times, and not that you learned it by me mentioning it, but I used it because we need to know it. Jesus warns people more about the sins of omission than he does commission. Because we are prone, and why we are, I don't know, to say, I don't do this, which is a sin, and I don't do that, which is a sin, and I don't run with those who do sin. I don't. Add up a column of zeros. What do you get at the bottom of it? As far as I know, zero. Well, of course we cannot practice the deeds of the flesh and go to heaven, but what replaces those in the life of one who wears the name Christian, which means of Christ? So it's all those things that we'll find ourselves leaving undone that God said we ought to do that's going to cause us many times to lose our souls. And I say again, every judgment parable the Lord gives, previewing what's going to take place in the judgment, is condemning people to torment because they left undone what they ought to have done. And that's something to think about, because it's in my own power and your power. What about our influence? Influence is our conduct of life that impacts somebody else, either for good or bad. Somebody says, well, he's lost his influence. No, he hadn't. You don't lose your influence. You either have a bad influence or a good influence. Do we influence others, or are we being influenced? The Bible says we ought to influence others. You're the light of the earth. You're the salt of the world. This kind of thing. Well, that means our thinking must be right. Our speaking must be right. Our actions must be right. And that means we're under the sway of the will of Christ. So my will to be faithful must be brought into subjection to Jesus Christ. You know, I knew a long time ago, as a young person, as a teenager, that the greatest challenge in a person's life is to live his life seeking daily to bring his mind in subjection to Christ in all things. Now, if somebody, I used to, when I was young enough to be called on to preach youth meetings, I used to say this quite often, that, oh, some of you think there's nothing to Christianity. It's just a bunch of stuff. You spend one day trying to subject your mind to the will of Christ as you learn it from his will, and you'll see what effort there ought to be put into living as God wants you to live, and that's day by day. No wonder the Lord said, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. So we are, or we must be, we should be, we ought to be, realizing those things that are in thine own power. Well, of course, this brings us down to the work of the church. In general, the work of the church is save souls. It's the spiritual body of Christ. It ought to be doing what the head directs us to do. It's to save souls. It saves souls through preaching the gospel to those who've never heard it, spiritually building up or edifying the body of Christ, and in the benevolent acts, doing for those who can't do for themselves. That's the way that we reach souls. The work of the church is primarily that of teaching the truth, either by example or word of mouth or any way that you can teach the truth. We can add to, or we can take from, the influence for good of this congregation right here. Now, the question I need to ask myself is, my influence for good over you, or is my influence that which is going to lead you into good? Or is my influence that which is leading you into that which is contrary to God's will, which is bad? We can attend Bible study or stay at home. If you stay home, that was in your own power. You made that choice. If you come, you made the choice. You made the choice to be here today. Others didn't. What went on in their mind, I don't know. They just made that choice. They had the power to not come, and they chose not to come. We can grow spiritually, or to put it rather bluntly, or we rot spiritually. It's in our power. That means we've got to spend a lot of time learning the Bible so we can know the will of Christ, so each day we can bring our lives in subjection to Christ. We have the power, it's in our power, to seek the kingdom of God first, like the Lord taught, or seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, second, third, fourth. After number one, it's all last. That's in my power. We can't blame anybody else. We can save our souls, or we can let the gospel and its influence die within us. That's in my power. And then the last thing is that, and we've already touched on it, is our final eternal destination. We have the power. I quoted this morning, to choose the straight and narrow way to heaven. Straight and narrow because it's hemmed in on all sides by the commandments of God. And you can't just nonchalantly enter it. You have to be willing to divest yourself of whatever keeps you from walking according to the commandments of God, or whatever adjustments you need to do. The only other thing that you can do if you don't go to heaven is go to hell. That's all. Everybody in this room is going to be in heaven or hell. Everybody all around us, out there on the road, everybody in this world will be in heaven or hell. That choice is in thine own power. It seems to be a thing of great comfort to some people to try to think, well, maybe I can blame it on somebody else if I'm lost, or maybe the Lord will have more mercy on me than what he does others because he understands my plight. No, God's mercy is extended through the gospel, through the commandments of Christ. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. John 14:15. It's in my own power where I take him at his word and really believe him, or whether I try to work it out to where, oh, I know what it says, but someone has said that life has but two ends. One has already been taken care of. You have the power to decide how the end will be. This hasn't been a very lengthy sermon, but I thought about this when I fell a couple of times this week when I got my feet all tangled up. And my reasoning was this. I chose to come and do some of these things, and it put me in the position to where I tangled my feet up and fell against my will. Well, don't you realize what's that saying? When you choose to obey the gospel and be active faithfully in the Lord's church, you put yourself in a position to be encouraged, to be strengthened by the fellowship of faithful brethren, to allow you to work with brethren. I'm giving you the motivating factor that at 17 years old motivated me to say, I want to preach. And here at 70 years old, it hadn't changed. I didn't know whether I could preach or not. John, I guess some people may still be wondering. But my reasoning was, if I put myself in the middle of all this, then that'll help me. There's a lot of things all through the years because I put myself, it's in my own power, I put myself into this, but also I put myself into it, tangled my feet up a lot of times. But it was a good kind of tangling. It was fighting for the Lord. It was a growing process. If we had just, there's a song like this, let him have his way with thee. We wouldn't be so messed up and caught up and fearful and agitated and falling over ourselves about what whoever does what in Washington or what's going to happen downtown or whatever. Just read your Bible. We win. You can't thwart God's will. Be thou faithful unto death. I will give thee a crown of righteousness, a crown of life. That has been my stay on so many occasions. Does it remove many times the pondering and the thinking and trying to use my mind based on the truth of what's the best way to go? No, that's all part of it too, you see. But what if I hadn't chose to become a Christian? What if I hadn't chosen to become a preacher as I've been? Be faithful. And it's true of any member of the church. What if I hadn't chosen to do that? Then I wouldn't have had those things crossing my mind. I wouldn't have had to make the deliberations on those things. I'd have been like most of the world out here, whatever the world does. So sometimes when we make those choices, the initial choices, the foundational choices, then they put us into a situation that helps us to grow and to develop and to be a greater service to the Master and a good influence over our brethren and a challenge to all of us to live closer to the Lord. And everything like this has been put in your own power and my own power. I must make the decision. If you're not a child of God this afternoon, As to whether you become one or you don't, that's in your own power. Whether you answer the gospel invitation or you don't, that's up to you. God will not force it on you. If you're a child of God and you're thinking in your mind that there are things that I know I'm wrong in, I should give up. I know I've done this when I knew better. I've neglected this. And boy, neglect is a biggie. It's where the sins of omission come in. Well, then it's time now from the heart to fully repent. Confess those sins and pray for forgiveness. Whatever the situation, it's in your own power how you treat this song, whether you'll stand up, whether you'll stay sitting there, whether you'll sing it, whether you'll sing it from the heart to God, what you'll do when you leave this assembly if time goes on. But we beg you to obey the gospel and do so while we stand and sing.